My name is Amrit Sarkar. I work as a cloud search reliability engineer at Lucidworks. Lucidworks is based out of San Francisco. We have offices all over the world. We have a product, Lucidworks Fusion, which is built on top of Apache Solr, which drives search applications. And we also provide consultations and support organizations who are using Apache Solr as their search or analytics purposes. So in this talk, we will first briefly introduce the parallel computing framework of Apache Solr. This particular topic has been discussed in multiple conferences many number of times, including Berlin Buzzwords, so we'll just glance over them. Then we'll move on to discuss some real-life use cases. These use cases have been adopted by our client at Lucidworks in one form or other. We'll have a demo application on top of Apache Zeppelin. Yesterday, there was a talk by Eric Pugh in the same lines. And we'll then analyze the performance of these queries of how they behave when they get executed. Finally, we'll list down an introduction to a statistical programming and see one of the use cases we can implement. So there are a number of tools and technologies already available. You can build your analytics application on offline data. You can pre-process your offline data to create certain views, which can further be used to create certain desired dashboards. The problem arises when you receive constant updates, and you need to refresh your analytics applications at regular intervals. So executing complex operations and correlations on unstructured and non-pre-processed data is extremely time-consuming. Also, we are dependent on multiple tools to bring together an entire analytics application. You need a database to store your raw data, an optional tool to pre-process it, and finally, a data visualizer on which you plot your dashboards. So the elements on the right-hand side comprise the parallel computing framework of Apache Solr. I hope everyone is familiar with Solr. It's an open-source search engine built on top of Apache Lucene library. And this parallel computing framework is only available in the Solrcloud mode, that is the distributed mode of Solr. We'll discuss the first four elements, while the last parallel SQL is a wrapper built on top of streaming expression. Whatever SQL query you provide to Solr gets converted to a streaming expression implicitly and gets executed against the servers. Starting with streaming API, it's a Java API available to perform real-time MapReduce and relational algebraic operations. You create streaming objects, like in this case, we have parallel stream, and you have certain APIs which you invoke to get stream of tuples. This tuple is a key value pair. It's a tuple stream object. And all the relatable streaming APIs and objects are available in the package, in the source code, solrj.io. To extend these capabilities of streaming API to non-Java folks who are building their applications on Ruby, Python, or any other scripting or programming language, streaming expressions were introduced. There are string query language and the serialized format for the streaming API. Streaming expressions compile to tuple stream, and vice versa, tuple stream can be serialized to streaming expression. You can use this directly via HTTP to Solr J. Solr J is a Java client for Solr. While these expressions can be executed against an implicitly available stream API, which is stream. Let's look at a very basic example. In this case, we are performing a search on top of a collection called getting started, and we are retrieving some information. So we utilize search streaming expression here and execute against the streaming API stream. This getting started collection, this getting started collection is hosted on a Solr cluster whose zookeeper string is localhost 9983. We only want to retrieve those documents which has the keyword hashbacks. We are limiting our result set to year 2014, retrieving field values, ID, and model name. And we finally want our result set in the ascending order of ID. If you look at the result on the right-hand side, on the top right corner, we have the graphical representation of the execution. You are pulling data from the getting started collection and performing a search on top of it. And the result set is in the form of tuples, in the form of rows. We have ID 1, 2, 3 in the ascending order as desired, along with their model names M and O. The last tuple of the result set is EOF endofile true with its response time. Response time is the execution time of these expressions against the Solr servers, in this case, which is 12 milliseconds. These expressions then can further be categorized based upon their usability. You have stream sources, which are the origin of tuple stream. You can pull data from a Solr collection via search or faceted streaming expression, while you can pull data from a relational database like MySQL or Oracle DB through JDBC. You have some advanced streaming sources like stats, topics, time series, train, which you can pull data from a machine learning model built in Solr or outside. Then you wrap around your stream sources with stream decorators. If you want to perform operations row-wise, that is, if you want to merge two result set, make an inner join, select only top five or only one to retrieve unique values, you have stream decorators there. Then if you wish to add another field value based on the existing values in a single row, you wish to perform operations column-wise, you have stream evaluators. You can perform straightforward mathematical equations like addition, subtraction, sine, cosine, tangent. And you can also perform conditional statements like if, else, then. As I said in the beginning of the talk, we will discuss some real-life use cases here. So let's first understand the data for the first use case. We have an information about some certain flights. We have the source city and the destination city for respective flights. And we want to determine all the destinations which are reachable from New York with a single stop, with a single layover in between. Now, there are a number of techniques available to achieve this use case. But here, with streaming expression, we would like to visualize the data in the form of a graph, such that we will put New York at the root node and do breadth-first search traversal. The inner node streaming expression will take the Solr collection of where the data is hosted, distances. We'll put the New York at the root node. And we gather all the immediate destinations from New York. These destinations will then become input for the outer node's streaming expression. And the result set, we have the node New York at level 0 as desired. And then we have a node called Bengaluru, which is at level 2, one away from 0 as desired. And we have ancestors Paris and New Delhi, such that you can fly from New York to New Delhi to Bengaluru, or you can fly from New York to Paris to Bengaluru. Then there is another very popular use case where you have a very large data set. Suppose you have a medical report for a patient or a lawsuit going on for a number of years. And with such huge data, you want to retrieve some meaningful keywords from those summaries so that you can understand what that data represent. Significant term streaming expression helps us perform that. In this case, I have utilized the data set enroll emails, which is very popular among the machine learning domain. I am limiting my data set to all the emails sent to a person called Dim Belden. The minimum number of documents these keywords should appear is 10. Not more than 20% of all the documents should have these keywords so that I can rule out the most popular common English words we use in our conversation, articles, prepositions, helping verbs, etc. And then the minimum length of those keywords should be at least 5. We receive the tokens, entities, and John G. Larea, which were the most commonly used keywords when someone was sending an email to Tim Belden. In the hindsight, significant terms utilizes the classic Solr indexes format, aggregate over the tokens, and calculate the relevance scores. So whatever we discussed until now was pretty straightforward. You utilized one single streaming expression and able to deduce your use case. Let's make it a bit more complex. Here we have two kinds of data set, one dynamic and one static, placed at two different locations. On the right-hand side, we have information about some certain organizations who have adopted certain campaigns. And we have the metrics in the form of weekly format. So for organization one, campaign one, we have 134 impressions, 48 clicks, and 4 order conversions. On the left-hand side, we have a static data, which is stored in a MySQL table. This data represents the cost incurred by each organization who have adopted this campaign. We have campaign 1 cost 6600 units, campaign 2 5840 units, and so on. And we want to calculate some meaningful numbers from here. We want to calculate conversion ratio, CTR, click-through rate, cost ratio, such that we can define and understand which campaign is working for which organization. So first of all, we need to bring these two different data sets from two different locations at one single view so that we can perform the operations on top of them. We need to join the cost data with the aggregated metrics per campaign. For the simplicity of for this use case, we will only calculate this for organization one. So first, we will start with a faceted streaming expression. facet essentially does bucketing over unique values. So we perform faceting over a weekly data, limiting our limits data set to organization one, and we bucket over campaign ID. So we segregate campaign 1, 2, and 3. And while we're performing that, we are having a summation of the conversions, impressions, and clicks. We will then wrap around our facet streaming expression with a select decorator, such that we just rename the newly created variables with just sum of parentheses of impressions to aggregated IMPR, and so on. And finally, we have our inner join streaming expression, where the first parameter is the select, while the second parameter is a JDBC source, which makes a live connection to a MySQL DB and fetches the currency, cost, and campaign ID. The result set of select and the JDBC source is then inner joined on the field campaign ID. Now, this looks like a big query. But if you look at the graphical representation in the top right corner, the picture gets much more clear what we want to achieve here. And if you look at the numbers, we now have all the data at one single view. For campaign one, we have the aggregated conversions, impressions, cost, clicks, respectively for other two campaigns. Now we just have to perform straightforward divisions and get our ratios. So we wrap around our inner join expression with another stream, another select decorator, and we perform straightforward divisions. We divide aggregated conversions to click to get our conversion ratio. For CTR, we divide our aggregated clicks to impressions, and similarly for campaign cost ratio. I hope these numbers are visible. If not, I'll just summarize. So for CTR, the campaign three is the best, it's 0.36. So for the CTR, the campaign three is working well for organization one, while for other two ratios, conversion ratio and campaign cost ratio, campaign one is the best. You can calculate these ratios in much more complexity and have multifaceted rankings too. You can have time series ratios, and you can plot such graphs like we have on the right-hand side. For this particular talk, I have plotted the graph on Apache Zeppelin using a Solr interpreter, which has been open sourced by Lucidworks. And let's quickly have a look at the demonstration. So we have conversion charts for organization one. We have the global conversion ratios. You can plot line graphs, scatter plots, cost ratios. And if I click on show code and make it a bit bigger, you can see the exact expressions getting executed. This is making a live connection to a Solr cluster and a JDBC MySQL table, and fetching the data and plotting the pie chart here. Similarly for the other dashboards. All the configuration raw data related to this application is open sourced on a GitHub link, which I have mentioned on the references page. Any questions until now? Everything is fine. Anything which we need to maybe revisit? Cool. Moving on. So now what I want to do is I want to store the metrics we just calculated in another collection, so that we can have some kind of like a report. It can be weekly, biweekly, annual, biannual, right? So we have an update expression which will wrap around our select expression we created in the previous slide. And we will send the documents, the numbers crunched, to a collection called report. If you look at the representation, you can see how we have reached here. And if you look at the result, we have total index 3. That is, 3 documents are being indexed for campaign 1, campaign 2, and campaign 3. While we have something called worker here, which is currency cost shard for replica in 14. All the use cases we discussed until now has been executed by single server only. There's been no parallelization being involved. And assuming there are n number of rows involved in the execution of this particular streaming expression, the big O complexity of this becomes big O notation of n. We will use this in later slides. So we have a concept called shuffling in streaming expression. The request which is received from a client to the stream handler is being forwarded to the workers. In this case, we have 5 workers. Now, I hope everyone understands what's a Solr collection, right? This is a logical representation of the data. In our Solr collection, we have 5 shards, 1 to 5, with 2 replica each. So such that we have 10 cores comprising our Solr collection. This worker will then request data randomly from these cores, such that each shard is being requested at least once. So worker 1 can pull data from shard 2, replica 2. Worker 3 can pull data from shard 1, replica 1. Similarly, worker 5 can pull data from shard 3, replica 2. Now, these workers will receive shuffled streams. They will perform the stream decorators and evaluators on top of them, send back the result back to the stream handler. The stream handler node will aggregate or will merge all the result set and send it back to the client. Now, suppose there can be a use case where you want to control the information or the related data you want to send to a particular worker. Suppose you have a data set called education, and you want to send all the data related to mathematics to worker 1, related to science to worker 2, and similarly for other workers, such that when you perform the numbers, the operations on top of them, they generate meaningful numbers. So we have a concept called control shuffling. I have termed this myself, where each worker will fetch data from each shard. It will request at least one of the replicas from each shard. After fetching the data, it will filter depending upon what it wants to work upon. So it will create an own subset, S1, and then perform the operations on top of it and send back the result to the stream handler node. So the workers we discussed until now are just regular Solrcloud collections only. They can be created just in time, they can be empty, or they can host their own data. They are responsible to perform the stream aggregations. The goal here is to separate out data fetching from data processing. You can have your worker collections on an entirely new set of servers, which are hosted on a different Solr cluster, while you can have a data on a separate Solr cluster, your primary data. So I hope everyone is still with me on the use case we discussed two slides before, where we crunched some numbers and indexed to a collection called report. Now we want to do the same use case this time parallelly using n number of workers. Now this looks like a big query, but we have reached until the update. We'll wrap around our update with a parallel streaming expression whose first parameter is the worker collection, which is worker here itself. It is hosted on the same Solr cluster whose zookeeper string is localhost 9983. I'm utilizing only 3 workers here since we have 3 campaigns. And I want the final result set in the ascending order of the campaign. Now, we discuss something about control shuffling. If we require to have the numbers correct and legit, we need to send all the data of campaign 1 to one of the workers, campaign 2 to the other worker, and respectively for campaign 3. That control shuffling is regulated by partition keys, which needs to be specified in the stream source. So here we have 2 stream source, facet and stream search. And we have specified the campaign ID as the partition keys. Now this is, again, the graphical representation. You can see now a 3 parallel execution being happening. On the right-hand side, now each worker is responsible to only index 1 document. They're responsible to process 1 type of campaign only. And if we try to understand the performance complexity, this looks like a very weird thing. But we have a overhead of merging this result set from each worker. Let's denote them as ZW. While the number of rows now being processed has been increased by the number of times or number of workers we have involved. Assuming the number of rows being processed are much larger than the number of workers we have specified, we can safely say we have been able to improve the execution of these streaming expressions by the number of workers we have introduced. That is big O notation of n divided by W. Obviously, there can be some edge cases. One important thing to note down in using these workers is, assuming you have a finite number of servers, how many workers you need to use? 2 less workers will underwhelm your server's capacity, while too many workers can overwhelm them. So you need to perform some proper POC, understand your data, understand the metrics you are generating, and then decide on a workers number. So this was until now, which has been introduced in streaming expression, I think a year or year and a half ago. So what is new is statistical programming, which is getting added. The new functions are getting added every week, every month. So now Solr's powerful data retrieval capabilities can be now merged and combined with in-depth statistical analysis. You can perform covariances, correlations, calculate Euclidean distance, plot Gaussian distributions, normal distributions, and much more using statistical programming functions. The syntax of the statistical programming are used to create arrays, which can then further be manipulated, transformed, and analyzed. You can train your machine learning models, you can predict data from historical data, and much more. And all this statistical function library is backed by the Apache Commons Math Library. Let's look at a very simple use case here. So we have some information about some stock prices for certain companies. We have their closing points for a period of 4 years. And what we want to calculate is, what we want to determine is the correlation between these stock prices. That is correlation of how one company's stock prices is behaving with the other. So the correlation measures the extent the two variables fluctuate with each other, which means if stock prices for company A is going up, and at the same time stock prices for B is also going up, they are positively correlated, otherwise negative. So to determine for this use case, we will just calculate the correlation between A to B. And we have our first expression, the starting is a let streaming expression, which allows us to define variable within a streaming expression. Then we execute two different search expressions here, which will first make a data set of only stock A data set. And we have another search streaming expression, which will only contain data for stock B. And we assign it to the variables of the same name, stock A and stock B. These variables, stock A and stock B, will then become input for another statistical function called call col. And we will pull the closing points from those tuples. These call functions create arrays from the list of tuples. And then these variables, prices A and prices B, which would be two different arrays, will then become input for another statistical function called Pearson product moment correlation, defined by cor, which will analyze and determine the correlation between them. This Pearson product moment correlation plots an XY graph of the two variables. And if the lines are parallel to each other, the number is closer to 1. Otherwise, it is close to -1. So let's look at the numbers which has been calculated. So we have the correlation of 0.999 for the stock prices for A to B. Suppose in the future, a new CEO is going to be appointed for the company A, or a new brand ambassador is going to be announced, and you expect the stock prices for company A to go up, you can safely predict the stock prices for C will also go up. While the correlation of stock prices of A to C is -0.18, the trend of the stock prices for company A has nothing to do with the trend of the stock prices for company C. Further, this statistical programming function now can now be integrated with our Apache Zeppelin. In this case, we have some latitude, longitudes being plotted on an OpenStreetMap. And we can also have some now more beautiful visualization of the pie charts. Here we have a different products which has been plotted. Some more interesting visualizations are also available. We have some calculations. We can plot distributions, bar charts, multiple line charts, scatter plots like this, and heat maps, and much more. Now, streaming expressions has made its mark into some other fields too. Like deep linking 4j is a commercial grade open source distributed deep learning library written specifically for Java and Scala. And we have something called dataset iterator in deep linking 4j, which handles the traversal of the dataset so that you can train your models. In deep linking 4j version 1.0 beta 2, a tuple stream dataset iterator has been introduced. Now, this dataset iterator can now fetch data from any Solr collection on a JDBC or a JDBC based databases, and you can perform your machine learning models. You can train the models and generate predictions. So all the use cases and the examples discussed in this particular talk is available on the GitHub handle Sarkar Amrit 2 Stream Solr. Please check out the official documentation of streaming expressions and statistical programming. This talk is heavily influenced by the work done by Joel Bernstein, Dennis Gov, and the people at Alfresco. And I have heavily utilized this material from Joel Bernstein's blog. Please check out the Zeppelin visualizer, which will be part of the official Solr documentation in very near future. There has been a very wonderful talk on the statistical functions by Joel Bernstein last year at Activate, which is applied mathematical modeling. Check it out if you want to see how many new, what new functions has been added, along with some others from, along with some other talks from last 2 years. And that's it from me, actually. Thank you so much for being here, being this late. And I'm open to some questions.
OK, we are left with more than 10 minutes.
Yeah.
So.
OK.
Thank you for the talk. Can you quantify, like, give us an idea of how many of your customers are using using streaming expressions right now? Just get an idea.
Yes, so they are utilizing streaming expressions, specifically stream decorators, for their aggregations. So one example I can give is we have a Solr collection which is being created on a daily basis. We have a set of Solr collections on a monthly basis, on a yearly basis. And these all different collections are then merged by the streaming expressions, and some meaningful metrics are performed on top of them. Now, for data visualizer, they are using Apache Zeppelin for some applications. For some, they have their own in-house data visualizer.
Hello. Do you know of any use cases that use the JDBC or any of the other non-Solr streaming sources?
Sure. So at Lucidworks, we have multiple clients who are hosting the data on a relational databases. So we have something called Lucidworks Fusion, which crawls data from the MySQL data, while streaming expressions allows us to directly connect to that and retrieve data and then do the stuff. Yeah.
OK, so I guess how performant is that within Solr? Is it memory intensive? Is it basically the same as just getting data out of Solr?
Sure. Yes, too many workers can overwhelm your data. And if you're not using parallelization, you are really dependent on the speed at which each tuple is getting read and getting operated, getting crunched. So it is memory intensive. When we say memory intensive, we recommend to you to have a separate Solr cluster for the workers and perform the operations there. You can have some beefy machines there. While you host your data on not-so-beefy machines on a normal Solr servers, and you know, just separate out the data processing from data fetching.
So if you have one cloud, but all the data and collections are living in half of it and doing the work on the other half of the machines, would that be relatively the same? Like, instead of having a separate cloud for workers and for...
Okay. True. Yeah, you can have a separate collection within the same cluster, which can be hosted on separate machines. Yes.
Okay. Thank you.
Thank you.
More questions? Okay, then. Amrit, we thank you for making time for this.
Sure. Thank you.
And we thank all of you for being a part of Berlin Buzzwords and staying till the last session. We hope it was a great time. And thank you so much.
Thank you.